Take five strangers who think they're the perfect host. Make each of them hold a dinner party.
They're supposed to turn out in perfect mounds and they do wobble like...
Add a bit of spice by asking them to mark each other's efforts.
Actually, what everybody said about the patty, I'm thinking...
Then sit back and watch as they battle to win a £1,000 cash prize.
Bring it on, baby.
This week's chefs come from Cambridge, home to 35,000 bicycles, 25,000 students, and plenty of punts. A city where charming countryside nestles neatly by picturesque colleges. And home to our first host in the fight for the £1,000 prize, mum of three and part-time photography student, Rachel Tuher-Rudd.
I do enjoy doing lots of things at once. Probably do too many things at once, and I just get by doing lots of things at the same time by the skin of my pants, just... managed to get through with it all, somehow.
Swapping her camera for the kitchen, 36-year-old Rachel is no stranger to cooking under pressure.
I just love cooking. And if anything goes wrong, it'll be, you know, it's not going to be awful. And it'll just be, you just got to go with it kind of thing and be relaxed about it.
Tonight, Supermum Rachel will be trying to impress four complete strangers with her menu, a feast of fresh ingredients. Which kicks off with a starter of baked figs and goat's cheese on brioche with a pink peppercorn sauce.
Brioche surprises me, actually, because I think brioche is something you put... I put Nutella on, actually.
Stars shining bright above you.
Tough-talking guest number one is Simone Brennis. German-born, she fell in love with England and moved her family to Cambridge 7 years ago.
I'm not really somebody who likes going to restaurants because normally I'm disappointed, actually. Very often I think, not quite, or I could have done better, or my mother definitely could have done better.
Wouldn't like to be in Rachel's shoes now.
I get teased by I'm the domestic goddess, but, you know, obviously it's a joke, but actually I don't think it should be a joke. I think it's really true.
Let's hope guest number two can meet Simone's standards.
Amazing. Really worked.
I think the fact that I've done a lot of the background to the food, either growing it or rearing it or butchering it or whatever, it adds something, and everybody seems to enjoy that more when they come round for dinner.
Back to Basics fan Phil Webb gave up his job a year ago to become a house husband and look after his two young daughters.
I take them to preschool or nursery and I play with them in the afternoon, and it's just a great way of doing something different with your life. And if you're going to bring up children, I like to think that you're going to have a big part in that.
Back with today's host, Rachel, her first job is a shopping trip to buy the ingredients for her main course. Monkfish with crushed potatoes, olive oil, watercress and lemon and garlic green beans.
Well, that sounds fantastic.
This is a very, very nice main.
Hi, hello. I've got some people for dinner tonight, so I've got a long list of things I need. I don't know if you can help. Lovely. Ten fresh figs, please. Yeah, cool. Excellent. If I can't get it, I'll just use what I've got, and if it's close, then it's fine.
Unfortunately, close enough simply isn't good enough for guest number three.
My husband thinks I'm incredibly high maintenance. He had no idea what he was letting himself in for when he met me when I was 18. Of course, I hadn't a clue then, and now I know there's a whole world of things out there that I can have, and I will.
32-year-old Gail Norris is an estate agent and lover of all things fine.
I always like to have the newest thing out, just for my own pleasure, not to upset anybody. I just like to be that way.
With hard-to-please diners, it looks like Rachel's decided to take a risk with an unusual dessert. Rhubarb in slow gin with chocolate brownies.
Ah, don't like rhubarb. Forgot to mention that.
Well, never mind. Rachel's last guest is jazz singer Carolyn Tyser, who loves to take centre stage.
The closer you get, the better you look, baby.
And to cap that, Carolyn reckons she's a great dinner party guest.
My friends will tell you that I am big, bubbly, and often quite loud and in your face. and can be quite scary to people that haven't met me before.
Good luck, everybody. Food shopping done, Rachel next tries to find something to drink.
I don't know much about wine, so I need your help.
This bottle, this is a Moscato.
So she decides a spot of wine tasting is in order.
That's very different.
So you can smell it, minerally, it's a little bit oily. It's Rosé de Kirwan. The Mills Reef Sauve Blanc. Mm-hmm. It's extremely good.
Steady on, Rachel. You've still got a three-course meal to prepare.
Eggs. You don't have... All I need now is eggs. You don't have eggs.
Sorry, we don't sell eggs
no,
at the store.
I thought not.
Yep, she's lost it. Back at home, Rachel's roping in her entire family to give a helping hand, starting with daughters Molly and Betty.
Right, Molly, can you string this rhubarb? You see these bits here?
Rachel cuts 750 grams of rhubarb into short lengths, pulling off any strings.
I thought you'd gone to the shop.
No, do you need me to?
Yes, please.
When?
Now!
That's husband Greg under the thumb. Don't think that's the last we'll see of him today. To make marinade for the rhubarb, they stir together 8 tablespoons of sloe gin, 2 tablespoons of water, and 100 grams of sugar. It's poured over the rhubarb and after a quick stir goes into the oven for 40 minutes.
Excellent, well done, miss.
With so much going on, Rachel still needs to buy her fish. But guess what? She's getting some help as her local fishmonger delivers it straight to her door.
Excellent. I've got 4 strangers coming for dinner tonight.
Have you?
Yeah.
You know them?
No, strangers.
Oh,
okay, thank you very much.
I'll see you soon.
Okay, thanks ever so much.
Will that be the wine or the sloe gin, Rachel?
3 o'clock. Everyone's going to be here in 3 hours.
Don't worry, Rachel. Help is at hand.
Well done, good lad.
Greg's only just delivered the food, but she's not finished with him yet.
Do I need to go and get this hot stuff?
Yes.
When?
Now.
While the rhubarb's cooking, there's just enough time for a quick tour of Rachel's house.
I love all our bits we've collected from holidays. We've been on holiday to different places. Sorry, I've got someone attached to my leg. This is, I think, we bought in Malaysia. Throw it down. We've lost it. It makes a good musical instrument. Yeah. Greg, can you call Tam?
Rachel's husband, Greg, is here to help.
It's kind of eclectic, really. Each room's a different feel and a different... I think it's a bit like me, a bit sort of all over the place.
Next, it's the chocolate brownies, and once again, the kids are roped in to lend a hand.
Right, Molly, I'd like you to cube the butter for me.
They melt 200 grams of dark chocolate with 200
right,
grams
Molly,
of butter.
I'm going to put these on a banh-mi, I think it's called. Ow! Hot!
They put 3 eggs in a mixing bowl.
Right, OK, now we've got shell in there. Top tip, use the other bit of shell to attract the other bit. Mmm, that works well. OK, I'll go to the tried and tested method of a teaspoon.
After adding 250 grams of caster sugar, Rachel stirs in the chocolate mix before adding some flour and some vanilla essence. The brownies go into the oven for 35 minutes and the leftover mix goes, well, everywhere else.
I'm feeling very tired now, suddenly thinking, reality's hitting.
Yes, Mummy's tired now. With Grandma taking the kids, Rachel's lost 3 of her assistants. She's only got 1 left, but she's working him ruddy hard.
24 inches. I've just remembered it's adult, so I'm not adult later, I'm sorry.
So, with her husband enslaved, Rachel starts cooking by herself, but there's a problem.
Now, they're not looking so good on top, but they're definitely cooked. Do you know what, guys? I'm going to make them again quickly.
She may be all smiles, but Rachel's determined to make the perfect dessert and win that £1,000 prize.
Will her brownies work second time around? Will it be success for Rachel?
Hey, that's my job. Leave the voice over to me and get cracking.
Now, you can see it's a different consistency now. It's thicker, it's not as runny as last time.
There are less than 2 hours before the guests arrive, and despite all that help, Rachel's finished just 1 of her 3 courses. She's finally realised she's running out of time, so she moves quickly onto the starter. She chops the figs, then grills some brioche. Next, it's the sauce, and she's using pink peppercorns, which are actually berries. She crushes them with 8 tablespoons of warmed honey.
I'll scream at Greg, ask him to go and get me some water. Greg!
He's probably scrubbing the front step, Rachel. What's going on with this starter, anyway?
I wonder if that's all right, because it bubbled. Just going to try it. I'm going to make that again. It's because I went to call Greg, I wasn't thinking.
With under an hour to go, Rachel can't afford any more mistakes, and there's still the main course to prepare.
Right, I'm going to ring Greg and see where he is. I think he thinks that he's off thing.
10 minutes on her own and Rachel's already panicking.
Hi, it's Rachel. I just wondered if Greg's there. I'll call back and see if you answer. Bye.
He's probably gone down the pub, Rachel, and who could blame him? She decides it's time to make the dessert look pretty. Isn't it a bit early for that?
Right. I probably should have put that on at the last minute, shouldn't I?
Yes. It's melting already. So yet again, Rachel's starting afresh.
I think I said about 10 minutes ago, I'm really excited now, I'm looking forward to it. I've now changed my mind.
Well, at least she's found husband Greg, and surprise, surprise, she's set him to work again, while she, well, she gets changed.
She seems to be all right so far, but I think she's on the edge, let's say.
And staring into the abyss. At least her husband has faith.
Right, ready? Ready or not, here they come.
With a starter and main course still to cook and no more helpers, hello. Time's finally run out on Rachel.
Hi. Hello.
First guest to arrive is Simone.
The sun's coming out, so I thought we'd have a drink out here. It's not cold.
Actually, do you mind maybe putting the kettle on for me because I don't drink alcohol?
No, okay, yeah.
Maybe a peppermint tea.
I have peppermint tea. I will put the kettle on. No, at all. Gosh, no, that's lovely.
That'll have to wait, as Rachel's second guest, Gail, is already at the door.
Hello, come in, hi. Hello, Rachel. Hello, Gail. Well, we'll get to each other by the end of the week, so yes. Gail, this is Simone.
They've only just met each other, and straight away they're talking about the opposite sex.
Yeah, two men would be lovely. Sort of 40-ish, for a sense of humour.
Yeah, sounds good. Yeah.
You're in luck, ladies. It's Phil.
Hi, hello. Come in. Hi, Rachel. Hello, Phil.
Nice to meet you, Rachel.
You too. Well, we're just taking bets. A man! Hey! Don't tell, this is Simone. Girl or boy? Are you going to be outnumbered or no?
I hope it's another fella.
Oh, come on.
No, just to even it up a bit.
Last but not least, it's Carolyn.
Hello, hi.
I'm outnumbered.
Phil, you're outnumbered.
Hi. Hello.
This is Gail.
Don't look too disappointed, Phil. Five knights and four women.
Cheers, everybody.
So. Cheers.
Here's to a good week.
Yeah.
Tonight, giggly mum of three, Rachel Tuher-Rudd, is throwing a dinner party for four strangers who will mark her efforts. They're all cooking as well, and the top scorer will win £1,000. Despite lots of help from her family, Rachel's running behind schedule and still has two courses to prepare. So she wastes no time in getting on with the starter. Rachel bakes the figs for 10 minutes before adding goat's cheese. The figs go on the brioche and back in the oven for another 5 minutes. With the starter seemingly under control, what does our host think of her guests?
They're all really nice people. You immediately like them and just think it's going to be a fun evening. So, no, it's all right. I've just got to cook now.
With Rachel occupied in the kitchen, her guests take the opportunity to have a good look round.
She's got earrings on. I don't know, she's been on a diet. What do you reckon?
Oh, what is this?
I played with that one. Oh, of course. Yes.
It looks good on you.
What's that do? Frog?
Ooh.
Or a rabbit?
At the moment, it's all okay. I'm just waiting for my what's-its in there. I've forgotten what they are, but they're in there.
Finally remembering what she's cooking, Rachel finishes off the dish by pouring on the dressing. For her starter, Rachel is serving baked figs and goat's cheese on brioche with a pink peppercorn sauce.
I'll just...
Wow. Ooh, it looks really interesting.
Oh, it might be a bit cold. Okay, guys.
Wow.
Right, I need to salt the fish. I'll be 1 second.
As her guests wait for Rachel to join them, she's still got a main course to prepare. Looks like she might have a riot on her hands.
I know. Salt... Not working. cold already. Okay, go on. Back.
On.
I'm out. Get set. Go. Oh, wine.
Blimey, this is all getting a bit Abigail's party, isn't it?
Hello. Go on then. Take it.
They can start.
Oh, no. I haven't eaten all day. I've been so nervous. It's just, I've had the odd piece of cake and that is it.
I left some of the fig on my plate because I enjoyed the flavours altogether. So once I'd run out of a little bit of goat cheese and a tiny bit of brioche, then it sort of lost it all for me and it went back to being just a fig.
I actually wondered whether I was supposed to eat the skin because the skin is a very different texture, but it all went down very nice.
And also the pepper. Actually, the pepper gave the whole thing the last kick.
I was a little apprehensive about the starter because as a kid, I really didn't like figs. I thought they were a horrible, scary thing that my mum ate at Christmas. Definitely converted. I do like figs.
Just wondering if you can convert me on the sweet as well.
Well, I'm not sure myself.
I have to agree again. That was my other point. Yeah. Rhubarb. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Well, I'm with you.
Yet before she dishes up that tricky rhubarb pudding, Rachel has a main course to think about. And she's got a top tip to share with her fellow diners.
Tell you what, the day you have a thing, your partner is like so compliant. He did everything. I was like, can you do it? Yeah, okay. Do
can it. I borrow yours for my day?
You can actually.
Greg certainly got you through the afternoon, Rachel, but you're on your own now.
They're all very complimentary about the start, which is lovely. So let's just see if I can get this done.
Rachel salted her fish 15 minutes before cooking. She starts by searing the fillets in an oven-proof pan to give them a bit of colour.
It's quite hard to get fish just right, so I'm hoping I'll be able to manage that. If I can brown it off nicely, and then, oh, did I put the oven on? Have I put my oven on?
Hoping Greg would have done it, Rachel.
You look as if you can do with a little skip.
Aww, you are lovely. Thank you. Thank you. I kidding. It will help.
I'm not sure the wine's going to help at all. With the fish seared, Rachel puts it in the oven to roast for 10 minutes before turning her attention to the crushed potatoes. Leaving the skins on, Rachel's added olive oil before gently crushing, not mashing, the spuds.
Mash is a very different sensation in the mouth. Sounds grand, doesn't it?
Oh, if you say so. Finally, she stirs in the watercress. If you fancy getting your husband to help you make Rachel's recipes, check out the Channel 4 website.
Okay. Ooh, it's hot. That is hot.
Oh, golly gosh, a hot pan. Well, I never.
Right, need to let the fish stand for a few minutes. So, whilst that's standing, I shouldn't have done that.
That seems to have been a theme today, Rachel.
Okay, so I am having a hot flush.
Right. Next, Rachel adds garlic and lemon to her green beans. Finally, our frantic host serves monkfish, crushed potatoes and green beans.
Hi. Hey.
What is so funny, Rachel?
So I didn't know what crushed potatoes was going to be like. I thought, oh, is that posh mashed potatoes?
I know, it's a bit of because I did just copy the... Sorry, I'm going behind you.
That's all right.
I did just copy the Rick Stein. It's Rick Stein.
Oh, never reveal your methods, Rachel. That could cost you the £1,000.
Very good.
Just the rhubarb's going with Jen.
I'm not a real fish fan, actually, but this is really good.
Oh, I love fish. I love the smashed potatoes and I love fish. I thought it was a really, really nice main course. Not too heavy, not too light.
And then the dressing. This was also good. She put some olive oil or something and some vinegar. If you would have told me this before, I would have said, oh, I need my sauce and, you know, when I fry fish and I make a nice fish sauce because I'm a very saucy person, but it just worked.
And how's Phil coping as the lone man?
It's been really nice of being included in everything and they've not just talked girly things, so that's been a bonus.
As soon as I saw Rachel's really lovely smiling face, it was just such a relief. She was so lovely and everybody else was so lovely.
Simone's fabulous. I think she's a complete wild card, really. I think, you know, she could go any way during the week. I think that that's where you're going to get your fun.
My first impression of the group was I thought, yes, this is going to work because they were all kind of not too English, really, you know, like not, you know, I can't say this, you know, all English people who are watching me now, cut.
Uh-oh, will Simone like Rachel's traditionally English dessert? Time for a second stab at that creme fraiche.
It is crunch time. We'll see if you like it or not, but it doesn't matter because they're all lovely, so don't mind. I've had a glass of wine.
You've had several. She's serving rhubarb in slow gin and chocolate brownies.
Right, rhubarb and chocolate brownie, so you can see what you think. If you don't like it, that's absolutely fine. Hit the brownie. Ignore the rhubarb and hit the brownie, honest. I don't mind at all.
It's not as bad as I remember it.
You've tried it.
I've had a good go.
Well done.
I've done as best as I can with rhubarb.
Drink! I will eat anything. I'm going to eat this rhubarb.
As the night draws to a close, how did Carolyn and Gail really cope with dessert?
I think I ate my rhubarb up like a good girl and did my host proud.
Rhubarb is still on my number one hate list, to be honest.
I'm secretly going to steal that recipe, I think. It's really nice. And Rachel served it up in a really nice way in the little old teacup she bought from Oxfam.
But how does our jolly host think the night went?
I had a lovely time. I think everyone else had a lovely time. It was really enjoyable. Hopefully it went really well. I'm tired.
But it's not up to Rachel.
I'm going to give Rachel an 8. She's my benchmark. I think that was a great meal. Monkfish meat was a little bit rubbery, perhaps. It wasn't the best fish I've ever had, but the hostessing of the evening was fantastic.
I'm going to give Rachel a 7 because I thought she was a brilliant hostess. I thought her meal was lovely. I wasn't too keen on the figs, although I have been converted.
For tonight, I'm going to score it a 6, purely because I'm not a fan of figs or rhubarb, but everything else was absolutely fabulous. I enjoyed it.
Very happy. 8. Because she's a very happy girl. And I think she, for the first evening, I think you couldn't have done any better. It was just, the food was good, the whole atmosphere was good. She made us feel good. You know, well done, Rachel.
Out of the chaos of the day, Rachel scores a competitive 29. Can host 2, Gail, do any better?
I'm not looking forward to tomorrow at all. I'm absolutely dreading it. I'm mortified that I have to do it, and I wish I could sit in everybody else's house every night and eat for 5 days instead of having to cook myself.
It's day 2 of our competition in Cambridge. Yesterday, giggly mum of 3, Rachel To Her Rudd, kicked off proceedings by enlisting her entire family to help with her classic menu.
Thought you'd gone to the shop.
No, do you need me to?
Yes, please.
When?
Now!
And all the assistants paid off as she scored an impressive 29 points. Today it's the turn of high-flying estate agent Gail Norris, who has a taste for the finer things in life.
If I have anything, I'd like it to be the best of things, purely for the fact that if you buy cheap, you buy twice.
Uncompromising about her standards, Gail's willing to go to any lengths to get things just right.
I try so much to aim for this level of perfection at all times. Sometimes my food lets me down and I get really disappointed.
Tomorrow's cook is the only man in the group, house husband and good life wannabe, Phil Webb.
To think that when people come round to eat at our house and I tell them, well, I've actually made this myself or I've grown this or whatever, that adds a certain personal touch.
On Thursday, it's German-born domestic goddess Simone Brennis, who is difficult to please.
Most of the time I think, I would do it a little different. Maybe it's something to do with because I'm a designer, because, you know, I'm very creative and I put all my creativity in my cooking.
Whilst Friday's host, marketing saleswoman and ex-singer Carolyn Tyser is relying on her entertaining skills to dazzle her way to the top.
Sweetest feeling, loving you.
My character has always been a bit of a show-off. And from a very young age at school, I got into the singing and the dance and the drama and was always picked for the leads.
Last night, Rachel battled with a series of crises.
I'm going to make that again. It's hot.
But she finally managed to serve some immaculately presented food.
Wow, restaurant quality.
The day went really well. There were some hiccups along the way with the brownies and the peppercorn. But at the end of the day, the guests topped it off and were just magnificent.
Rachel was brilliant.
Was spot on, and I think I can do very well too.
There was so much detail in her preparation and her home looked amazing. Actually, you know, it's making me feel a bit nervous about this evening.
She might be nervous, but today's ultra-competitive host is ready for the battle.
£1,000, who wouldn't want back. It's next year I go on holiday on Monday or Sunday or something to do with it.
With her eye on the prize money, Gail is off to the shops, and only the best ingredients will do.
I'm going shopping today at a higher-end supermarket. I go there because I feel the ingredients are lovely and fresh, and I certainly think you get what you pay for when it comes to food.
Yeah, I'm interested in the Madagascan prawns. OK. But what I want to know is, when I peel the shells off, will the tails remain on?
Yes. Just hold them like that, and then you pull it back, and then you pull the shell off, the tail should stay on like they have on the
Oh, fabulous, here. OK.
The prawns are for her starter, a vegetable and prawn tempura with a sweet chilli sauce.
Oh, wow! Not what I thought at all.
Spicy doesn't always like me, but I like spicy, so that looks really, really nice.
See, she was saying last night, oh, I can't cook, but you obviously can if you're doing tempura.
I'm not quite sure what a tempura is.
Well, you'll soon find out. Still on a mission to buy only the finest produce, Gail visits her local butcher for an unusual cut of meat.
Do you like it?
Yes, I do, yes. A lot of goodness in oxtail.
Oh, yeah. Lots of people sort of turn their noses up at it, don't they? But I quite like it.
It's very good.
Gail has decided to cook oxtail stew, a risky and old-fashioned dish. This is only one of her main course dishes. She also plans to serve Thai green chicken curry and rice.
I'm not quite sure I understand that. It's going to be Thai green curry with rice. So where does the oxtail stew come in?
To me, this sounds like an unusual combination, but maybe a Thai expert would say, oh, this is so spot on. So I don't know.
What I wanted to do was cook what I love, which is sort of Asian cookery, Thai food, that sort of thing. I love anything that's got an Oriental influence. But I also wanted to introduce a little bit of my background, which is West Indian. I'm from Jamaica. But, you know, I wanted to take the myth out of them, that they're not these really horrible, jellified, and how could you possibly eat those?
So it's expense change.
Thank you so much. Nice to see you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Gail's final course is a frozen custard ice cream. Making your own ice cream is tough enough, but without the right gadgets, it's going to be even tougher.
And the reason why I'm having to do the ice cream so early is because I've actually haven't got an ice cream maker, so I'm going to have to hand churn. So I need to give myself plenty of time to keep coming back and mixing it. Otherwise, it'll just turn into a big lump of whatever.
And there's also another small problem.
On its own, I'm not a real ice cream fan. My wife eats it by the bucket.
That sounds really interesting, because I'm not actually a lover of ice cream. I do like ice cream, but only occasionally.
I think Gail is taking the competition seriously, because otherwise you would do more simple stuff. I think she must have been quite happy yesterday after, you know, seeing Rachel's menu, which was really good, that she can really compete.
Gail may have played down her chances, but she's determined to win that £1,000 prize money. To make the frozen custard ice cream, she whisks together 5 egg yolks with 3 cups of sugar. She heats up 2 cups of milk, adds 2 teaspoons of vanilla essence, then folds the milk into the egg yolk and sugar mixture.
I've done this recipe once before and it was a complete disaster that I'd forgotten to go back and sort of mix it while it was in the freezer.
Gail then puts the mixture back on the heat and stirs it until it takes on the consistency of custard. She then needs to cool the mixture before it can go into the freezer. So she puts it in the bath.
It's extremely strange and usually I like to put it in the kitchen sink. However, somebody has removed the plug, so I don't know where it is.
Whilst the ice cream is enjoying a relaxing bath, Gail is having second thoughts about her risky main course dish.
The only concern I've got about them is that nobody likes them. I'm actually not that worried about cooking them, per se, though, you know, you can get it wrong and you can leave them in for too long and then they turn into soup, which I don't want this today. They're supposed to be in their solid form.
But there's no going back now, so she starts the cooking. She coats the meat in flour and fries it off.
I'm sealing the meat, apparently. It helps to seal the flavour in, apparently, in all the juices. Or as my mum used to call it, browning the meat.
To finish off the stew, she adds sliced onions, beef stock and seasoning, then puts it in the oven as she needs to allow the oxtails to stew for at least 6 hours for the flavours to develop and for the meat to tenderise.
That's it.
Before she starts to prepare the rest of her menu, our host takes a breather to show off the 4-bedroom house she lives in with her husband and 2 children. And like everything else in her life, it's immaculately presented.
This is my sofa, which We bought from a well-known London shop. It was a lot of money for something that nobody actually likes anymore. We've all gone off it. I love my curtains. This is something I love. They're natural fabric, really heavily lined, and they're handmade. The cost was around about £5,000.
£5,000 for curtains?
But I think they're worth it. I mean, they're up all the time and I don't have to do anything to them, just hoover them.
And you hoover them?
I had this made by a company in London to a specific sort of thing. Because I bought this chair and I needed the chair to clear underneath it, but I also wanted like a shelf as well so that I could get more on there. I think this is probably one of my favourite things, actually, because one thing that I didn't have to compromise on, it was absolutely exactly how I wanted it.
Are you getting the impression that our Gail is just a little bit fussy? Back to the cooking, and Gail begins to prepare the second dish in her main course, the Thai green curry. She starts by making the paste. She uses 4 green chilies, a handful of coriander, a small piece of ginger, 1 onion, and the juice of 1 lime. Gail has perfected this dish over the years and never makes it without her secret ingredient.
It's mango chutney, and the reason why I use it is it gives a sweetness to the meal that that I enjoy. I think it cuts through the heat of the meal, and I just literally just put a spoon of or so of it in and let it work its magic.
Next, she blends the ingredients together to form a smooth paste. Even though there's lots still to do, Gail is obsessed with every detail and won't be rushed. Everything has to be done in her own special way, even down to how she washes her chicken.
My mum always washed any meat in either vinegar or lemon because she felt, or, you know, she was brought up to be, you know, told that it kills bacteria. I can't see the harm in just keeping that practice up. It, you know, it doesn't do any harm and, you know, and I do believe it's true, lemon is quite antiseptic or whatever the word for it is.
With the chicken antiseptised, or whatever the word is, it's time to marinate it in the curry paste. Then she takes the custard ice cream out of the bath and whisks the mixture to create air bubbles before placing it in the freezer. If she wants the ice cream to turn out right, she'll have to remember to whisk it regularly throughout the evening. There's only an hour to go before her guests arrive, and Gail still has lots left to do.
We're trying to get done cooking the curry, laying the table. I have to prepare the salad garnish. I have to do the tempura batter and cook the tempura. Quite a bit, actually.
With so much to do, anyone else would be running around like a headless chicken, but there's no shortcuts for a stickler like Gail.
I do put a lot of pressure on myself to get things right. I wish I didn't. I think that it makes life difficult, and I'm sure I'd be so much happier if I could just let it be.
But Gail just can't stop herself. She still needs to cook her Thai curry and make the tempura batter, but instead, she's fussing around creating garnishes.
She could do a bit more of this.
They look fine to me, Gail. Please leave them alone. Finally, it's dawned on her that she's running out of time.
I think it's about 6:10. I can't see. I've still got quite a lot to do now because I was trying to time it so that it would be fresh for when they got here and ready. But, you know, the time has definitely caught up with me now and I've got quite a bit to do.
But she's determined to win, so she calls in the cavalry. Her neighbour Sam has been summoned to help.
Let me at least wash up.
I'll tell you what I could ask you to do is to just pull the meat off the bones. And what I want to do is not have any fat on it. So I think you probably need a knife and fork. Is there any left?
You got a sharp knife?
No, dinner knife will be fine.
While Sam gets on with the unglamorous job of taking the oxtail meat off the bone, for Gail, it's all presentation, presentation, presentation.
I'm just making sure that I'm... at least the first impression isn't too bad. And then I shall be one glass short.
Gail's oxtails have been cooking for 7 hours now. Instead of serving the meat as a traditional stew, she places it in ramekin dishes with broad beans to top it off. The oxtail will now be kept warm in the oven until it's time to serve.
I've got my ice cream for a little while, but I'm going to just give it a good little churn and get some air bubbles in there.
Gail finally starts cooking her chicken curry. She stir-fries the marinated chicken with French beans and baby corn before adding a can of coconut milk. The curry is cooked in about 10 minutes and will need to be warmed up just before it's served. Her guests are just minutes away, and Gail's attention needs to be on the ice cream and her tempura starter. But guess what she's worried about? Her appearance.
I'm feeling quite apprehensive about my food. I'm not sure whether or not it's going to go down okay. I hope it will. And, yeah, I look forward to seeing everybody's reactions on it.
You won't have long to wait, as her first guest has just arrived. It's yesterday's host, Rachel.
Hello. Oh, come in. Yes. Oh, it's nice to see you. Stunning.
Next to arrive is Simone.
Oh, wow. Lovely.
Here's Carolyn.
Hello.
Oh, come in.
And last is the only man in the group, Phil.
Nice to see you. Lovely to see you.
Gail has so much to do that once they're inside, she leaves them to serve themselves.
Stuff to prepare.
Yeah.
Oh, would you mind all
Not at all.
Thank you.
Gosh. No, I'm last awful. Night was the same.
To make my own drinks in this house.
Blimey, Gail, you should know better than that. Tonight, perfectionist Gail Norris is entertaining four guests who will secretly mark her efforts.
It's a swanky pad.
And it's gorgeous, isn't it?
Actually, I guess you might be quite stylish just by your glasses.
Oh, no.
At the end of the week, after they've all hosted dinner parties, the highest scorer will win £1,000. Gail's taken so much trouble preparing her food that she's running behind schedule, but she's still refusing to cut corners.
Serviettes. Oh, what did I do with them? I'm in a real dizzy moment now. I really want my linen ones. I don't want to put paper.
Whilst Gail fusses over her napkins, her guests enjoy a nose around the rest of her house.
Oh, lovely.
And
wow.
That's gorgeous.
Oh, look at the flowers.
That's
and
lovely.
It's a lovely
gorgeous table.
Would you put something like this in your house? Just be honest now.
No, I wouldn't.
Actually, I would. I love it.
You like that?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
It wouldn't go in my
nearly
house.
Nearly bought one of those.
But
no, I try to sit on it. You wouldn't.
It looks a bit delicate to sit on.
No, it's not.
That's all right.
Careful, Simone! Everything's handmade!
Beautiful.
Downstairs, Gail has her hands full frying her tempura starter. She made the batter with plain flour, egg, baking soda and cold water. To achieve that perfect crunch, she cooks the prawns and batter in super hot oil for just a couple of minutes. For her starter, Gail is serving a prawn and vegetable tempura with a sweet chili sauce. Time to find out whether all that effort spent on the presentation was worth it.
Oh.
No, but
I want to take it home and frame it.
Presentation is superb.
Not too bad. The worst is yet to come.
Her presentation was fantastic. She'd done this sculpture of greens, and there was a mango in there as well. I mean, I would never have thought of that. And it was nice to eat.
The pepper had still a little bite. It was just spot on, yeah. And then dipping in the sauce, and I ate the whole plate, even with the little tail.
The starter was lovely. I really looked forward to it, and it exceeded expectations.
Just wish there'd been more of it. It was lovely.
The starters have gone down very well, and even Gail is starting to relax and enjoy herself.
Yeah, let's have a Babs. What's that one she did with the Bee Gees? Is that the bit
guilty?
Because I got nothing to be guilty of. I love. I'll climb any mountain, near or far.
Yes, Carolyn's singing has struck a chord with Gail. Not sure which chord, but it's prompted Gail to ask her for a very special favour.
If you're interested, I'd love it if you sung a few numbers for me on Saturday evening. Saturday.
Why,
what is that? I'm renewing my wedding vows.
Really?
Yes.
Let's just hope your husband shares your musical tastes.
Nuptials revisited.
No, I mean, are you serious about becoming
a
singer?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think it'll be
really
wonderful.
Excellent.
Yeah,
it'll
be
excellent.
Really nice.
We have, Jill. I think because we are the same type of character, she's in sales, I've been in sales, but we both love our music and we just kind of get each other.
Everybody's really starting to really enjoy each other's company and finding out that there's enough sort of common ground for everybody, even though I'm the only bloke, you know, we're all having a good giggle.
The dinner party might have started well, but with two difficult courses to come, Gail can't afford to take her eye off the ball now. And she can't forget to stir that ice cream.
Just making sure it's smooth, that there's no icy lumps.
But should it really look like scrambled eggs? Next, it's the tricky main course to finish off. Gail reheats the Thai green curry.
God, I didn't even check this is microwave proof before I slammed it in there.
For her main course, Gail is serving a chicken Thai green curry and oxtail stew, accompanied with rice.
But anyway, yeah, but it's your hair we're discussing, not ours.
Which is even worse.
Oh, thank you.
But they're see-through.
It is not a combination at all. I really just wanted you to have a taste of something else that I do. I have
do you
done.
Like oxtail?
I do actually. I quite like the flavour of it. And I think a lot of people hate it, and I really want to sort of break a myth in a way. That it, you know, it's not that bad, and it doesn't have to be.
Quite strong flavour, isn't it? Quite strong.
The main course was really lovely. It was delicious. It was, as I expected, a Thai green curry to be. Not too hot, but just hot enough.
The oxtail stew and the curry didn't go together at all.
I do understand why she put them together. She wanted us to try oxtail, but oxtail is something I have actually cooked, so I was happy to see it there and taste it. I wasn't scared of it.
I was a bit taken aback by that. And when I read the menu, I didn't understand it, and now I understand it, but I still don't understand it, really. I'd have thought one or the other.
And we don't understand you either, Phil. Next, it's time to serve the dessert.
Oh, gosh, everything's frozen.
And it's the first slip-up of the night. The ice cream has frozen solid, and it's now too hard to serve.
I'm going to let it sit for a little while, because it is absolutely rigid, because I had it in the icebox.
The guests will have to wait for their dessert. Luckily, they're being regaled with tales from Carolyn's club singing career.
Definitely. And people used to say to me years ago, they used to say that they'd come into a room and be at the bar
shocked at your wife.
And turn around and go, oh, my God, she's white and skinny. You know, I was like a tiny little skinny thing, you know. And there was this big voice coming out that sounded like a black woman's voice. But
I'm saying nothing. The ice cream has softened enough to finally allow Gail to serve it.
Nice and soft. Now, I'm going to put these shop-bought, very naughtily shop-bought biscuits onto each plate.
Surely shop-bought isn't good enough for you. For dessert, Gail finally serves homemade frozen custard ice cream with blackberries and biscuits.
I'll take you two for once. Fantastic. Right, it's starting to go.
Blackberries, lovely.
Is it homemade frozen custard?
It is homemade frozen custard.
Is it?
It is.
Well, I must say, I'm not an ice cream fan.
No, I'm not.
But it was for this, it was okay for me. It's a good taste.
Well, thank you.
The night is over, and it's time to find out what the ice cream hating guests really thought of the dessert.
I like custard. I'm not a massive fan of ice cream, but I'll eat it. But that was really nice.
It wasn't really my cup of tea, the dessert. I'm a chocolate person.
The ice cream was a tiny bit icy. But it was lovely. The flavours went well together.
I think the evening went well. It was my sort of dinner party.
Well, time to find out if your guests agree. Scores, please.
I'm going to give Gail a 9 tonight because I thought the menu was excellent. I was looking forward to it from the moment I saw it. I enjoyed every course.
I'm going to give Gail a 7. Her food was absolutely wonderful. It was really tasty, really lovely, but I'd love to have had a big bowl of oxtail with maybe some green veg by the side.
I'm going to give Gail's cooking a score of 8 because it really was, it was great, and it was slightly better than Rachel's.
That makes 24 so far. With ultra-demanding Simone still to mark, Gail needs 6 or more to leapfrog Rachel and go top of the table.
Gail didn't make the dip for the tempura herself. She had little biscuits she didn't make. It was tasty, it was a fantastic evening, and I need to find a middle way between 5 and 10. I choose 7.
Get in! Gail scored 31 points, putting her in the lead for that £1,000 prize. But with 3 hosts yet to entertain, there's still everything to play for. It's day 2 of our competition in Cambridge. Yesterday, giggly mum of 3, Rachel To Her Rudd, kicked off proceedings by enlisting her entire family to help with her classic menu.
Thought you'd gone to the shop.
No, do you need me to?
Yes, please.
When?
Now!
And all the assistance paid off as she scored an impressive 29 points. Today, it's the turn of high-flying estate agent Gail Norris, who has a taste for the... It's day 4 of a very competitive week in Cambridge. Giggly mum of 3, Rachel, was the first to cook. Her strategy was to enlist all the family to help pull off her classic menu.
that bit over there.
It worked, as she scored a healthy 29 points. On Tuesday, flash... It's day three of the dinner parties for our Cambridge cooks. First to host was scatty mum of three and part-time photography student Rachel Tuher-Rudd.
Now, they're not looking so good on top. You know what, guys? I'm going to make them again quickly.
Who, despite a few hiccups, managed to make it picture-perfect on the night. She scored a respectable 29. Last night, it was the turn of image-conscious estate agent Gail Norris, who designed a stylish-looking menu.
It came out the way I planned. Certainly the presentation looked right, or how I had it in my head, so yeah, I was quite pleased with it.
Her attention to detail paid off, and she went top with 31 points. Tonight's cook is marine biologist turned house husband, Phil Webb, who after two evenings of sophisticated dining feels he's out of his depth.
Gail, she had square plates. Goodness me, you know, that's just fantastic. And I think I'm not even going to try and compete with that.
Phil's confidence may have taken a bashing, but tomorrow's host, self-assured Simone Brennis, firmly believes she has a fighting chance.
I know exactly what I want, I know how I want to do it, and I'm really confident. I sound like a boxer, you know, before you interview a boxer.
Then on Friday, outgoing ex-nightclub singer Carolyn Tyser is determined to be top of the pops. And the pots!
I think we're going to want something a little bit different on the last night. And I have got a theme, but I'm not going to let you know what it is quite yet.
This week's current number one, Gail, hosted an evening entirely in keeping with her perfectionist take on life.
I want to take it home and frame it.
Presentation superb.
I had a lovely evening. Lovely. I had a fun evening last night. It was enjoyable.
Everything was just seemingly perfect.
And it did actually come up to and possibly exceed expectations. It was extremely well presented.
Gail's night also saw the competition kicking off between the ladies.
Gail said, oh, you know, we're all quite leggy girls, aren't we? And then Rachel, I think, said, oh, get a tape measure out, then let's measure, you know.
43 again.
Yay. And then I said, oh, let's measure the width, because I knew I'd win this anyway. Not that I haven't won the length as well. Which is a lie.
Simone seems to be taking the competition to a new level. Leg length. Whatever will she measure next?
Afternoon, boys.
House husband Phil lives in a restored 500-year-old farmhouse in the beautiful Cambridge countryside with his wife and two daughters.
Can we do some play there?
No.
Giving up work has meant he can indulge his love of organic homegrown produce. Let it grow,
let it grow. I had absolutely no interest at all in gardening of any sort, really, until we got our own place. And the first house we had a tiny little bit of grass, and I thought, oh, I better cut that. And then I just started thinking, oh, I can grow things.
We will get decent, homemade English food. That's what we will get from Phil. In a decent, traditional home. It might be a farm, he didn't want to tell us, but it's a farm, I'm telling you.
I think it's going to be quite different. He's kind of talked about food, and I think he likes things that are quite different. I think he wants to surprise us, maybe shock us a little bit.
Yes, it is shocking. Phil's been a house husband for so long, he's now into the Women's Institute.
The Women's Institute, if what they don't know about jam making, I really don't think needs to be known. So, as far as I'm concerned, this is a bit of a Bible, and I'm surprised they let it out of their grasp.
Whatever next? Centrefold on this year's calendar? Nope. Pigs.
You've got your scraps with you. Have they been fed this morning?
Well, they've had their main feed, but they just...
Yes, Phil even rears his own pigs. And for one of them, it's game over.
Hey, piggies, come on there.
Tonight's homegrown menu is kicking off with coarse pork liver pate with homemade bread.
Pork liver pate on homemade bread. I'm really pleased with that. That sounds lovely. I love liver.
Wow, that's just what I expected from him. That'll be absolutely amazing.
I just hope it isn't from one of his... Well, someone that might have used to have been a pet at his, as he's going to be living in the country.
Sadly, Carolyn, you're dead right. One little piggy did go to market, but these little piggies stayed at home. For now.
Okay, let's get the liver out. Did you just take it out whole, or have you cut all the vegetables off?
It's
all prepared. Oh, fantastic. That's great. So it saves me some time.
2 kilos of liver has been trimmed down to the finished bit, 500 grams.
Fantastic.
That's what's left.
And,
Phil started preparing his pâté 3 days ago to allow the flavours to develop.
I'm just looking for little bits of membrane or tough ventricles of blood vessels and that sort of thing.
Nom nom. He puts liver, minced pork, breadcrumbs, herbs, nutmeg, shallots, garlic and port into a food processor and blends. He layers his own homemade bacon into a tin and fills with the pâté mixture. He makes a bain-marie and puts the pâté into the oven for an hour and a half. Once it's cooked, Phil will keep it in the fridge until he serves. For main course, Phil's chosen another of his favourite meat dishes, using up his recently butchered pig. Roast rack of pork Dijonnaise with seasonal local vegetables.
Well, where we have pork again, not very balanced, Phil.
It's all pork and I love pork.
Local vegetables, perhaps from the local farm shop, perhaps organically grown in his own garden.
Organic, yes, but not from his garden.
Oh, great. Thanks.
Even self-sufficient Phil sometimes needs help from the outside world.
Because I've run out of most of the veg, it's just the wrong time of year, I've started getting a box from a local organic supplier. Some friends up the road recommended them to me because they get local produce rather than exotic stuff flown in from wherever.
Highly commendable, Phil. Came about that 4x4. Just kidding. For dessert, Phil's serving lemon tart and creme fraiche. Yes, the man even bakes.
It's a typical menu, I think. Lots of meat, and you know, we have meat, a little lemon.
Lemon tart and creme fraiche. Oh, I love lemon, anything lemon flavour.
I think this puts Phil at number one. It's a great menu. It's absolutely fantastic.
Phil certainly knows how to woo the ladies. But will a basic cook, as he describes himself, be able to win that £1,000 prize?
I know I'm not a great cook. So there we go, that should be enough. I've kind of resigned myself to taking the attitude, well, it's good to take part. It's the taking part that's important.
How very British of you, Phil. Next job is the pastry for his lemon tart. Phil sieves flour, adds a pinch of salt and grates butter.
My butter, I just grate it straight in and it breaks it up nicely and it's quick. Because chopping butter can be a real faff.
Top tip, Pip. Maybe you're not so incompetent. He's making short crust pastry the cordon bleu way, so he's using 2 egg yolks.
So I've got an egg from the farm next door, and they're authentically from the farm next door because you can still see the chicken poo on them.
He adds the eggs, not the poo, to the blended mixture, then sugar and cold water to form the pastry before the tricky bit of rolling it out.
Just trying to be as gentle as I can, and look, I've got a split. I just didn't want that to happen.
Oh, I know, it's a nightmare.
Just see, now when I roll that out, that split's just going to get bigger. I'll try and squeeze it together, but...
For someone who's supposedly not a great cook, Phil certainly has high standards. He bakes his pastry base blind in the oven for 20 minutes.
At 170, and that's a fan oven. It would be 190 if it was a static.
Come on, Phil. Methinks you're a better chef than you're letting on. For his filling, he mixes lemon zest with lemon juice, adds eggs, almonds, cream, and stirs it all together. He pours his filling into his tart base and puts it back in the oven for 20 minutes. Then he makes a glaze of water, sugar, and lemons.
Lovely jubbly, give him a stir. Blah, blah, blah.
For the topping of his tart.
Oh, look at that. Gordon Ramsay, eat your heart out.
Are you mad, Phil? Do you like eating hospital food? He arranges his lemons into a pretty little display onto his tart. Those WI meetings are really paying off. And then pours on the glaze. He then puts it into the fridge to chill.
So I'm very pleased with that, apart from the pip. Look at that pip. Look at that pip. Got in there all on its own accord.
For someone who's just in the competition for the taking part, Phil seems awfully concerned with his presentation. For his main course, Phil removes the fat from his rack of pork to use for crackling. He butchered his pig with his own hands. Is this his alpha male streak coming through?
I think there's some primeval something or other, but not necessarily wearing this purple pinny.
Hmm, that'll be a no then. Next, he covers the meat with Dijon mustard, pats on breadcrumbs, covers with foil.
I'm just going to, I guess, cover this up just a little bit, because I don't want the breadcrumbs to burn.
And puts the joint into the oven.
Should be ready in about 2 hours, and then I'll need to let it rest. And I'm assuming everything is going to be slightly late.
With half an hour till the guests arrive, Phil makes his crackling. He rubs salt, herbs and pepper into the fat.
I really want to crush those leaves onto the fat to try and get some taste going.
If you grow your own vegetables or send your little piggies to market, you can find Phil's recipes on the Channel 4 website.
OK. Oh, that smells nice. Right, I'm just going to leave that there. What I intended to do was put everything on in the dining room just so the house fills up with the smell of bread, so hopefully my guests will come in and go, "Ooh, that smells good. What are you cooking there? Look at that, that's what I'm after."
You are so rumbled, Phil. No rubbish cook knows that trick. Just confess, man.
Yes, I'm competitive.
See, that wasn't too difficult, was it? With the competition only 5 minutes away, Phil seems to be having an attack of pre-match nerves.
I just decided I'm going to go and get changed first because it only takes a few seconds. And, yeah, I need perhaps a few seconds to collect my wits and put them back in the shaker.
Phil's decision to change may prove disastrous. He's wearing shorts. Hey, first to arrive is Simone.
You're looking great with your sexy sunglasses on.
Oh, and yeah.
Then Rachel.
Amazing. Give me a hug.
Oh, followed by Carolyn.
I'm fine. Mm-hmm. Rather nervous. But
and finally, Gail.
Come in.
Thank you.
Mwah.
You are now.
House husband and homegrown produce fan Phil Webb is holding a dinner party.
Cheers, everybody. Thanks Cheers. For coming. And I hope you enjoy this evening.
Thank you.
And score me highly.
His hosting skills will be marked in secret by his guests. At the end of the week, the host with the most points will walk away with £1,000. Phil's been tactically playing down his chances all week, but he's about to let the cat out of the bag.
Because I'm really competitive. I am, but I've been desperately trying to suppress my competitive edge because the last two meals have been absolutely stunning and I just cannot compete with that level of sophistication.
I think you're right.
Liar! Phil may have admitted he's competitive, but he's still playing the I can't cook game. In his rather fetching outfit, he checks on his pate that's been maturing for 3 days.
Some people might feel a bit kind of, oh, is it done or not? So I've actually made sure it was cooked through. So I'm pleased with that. It is almost very slightly pink in the middle there, but that's fine. That's good.
Meanwhile, his guests discover some home truths about their host.
Well, I think we may be looking under there. You do it.
I do. Why me?
Go on. Just in case there's. What do you think it is?
Homebrew.
I think this could be. I think this could be pork in jelly or. Wow!
Oh my God!
It is. It's the pork.
I'd rather see it when it's cooked and on my plate.
Oh no! Amazing.
Yeah, you can do the plain bit. I'll hold the brick.
Gosh!
Look at this. Do you think this is homemade strawberry jam?
Green jam.
He is doing this. He is making this. And he said he is not very good cook. I mean, why is he? What is he trying to do with us?
Oh, there's more.
You belong to Phil, are you the farmers? Oh, it's electric!
Unaware that his diners are being electrocuted, useless cook Phil finishes off his starter. He's serving coarse pork liver pate with homemade bread.
Did you say on Monday, I think, that you're not a cook? And
yes.
I think you did.
You told some real porkies.
No, I don't cook.
But my potatoes are stewing in the other room.
I just cook for my children.
The starter was absolutely wonderful, really tasty. I was a bit worried about the course. The boys got bits of fatty than I thought it might be. But it was just scrumptious, and I do think he actually could market it. He says he sells his honey at the local butchers, and I think there's space in the fridge for Phil's pate.
I never used to like pate, but I do eat pate now, but that is the best pate I've ever eaten. And the homemade bread as well. Any man that can make homemade bread, it's a shame he's married, really, isn't it?
The bread I was hoping was going to be awful. I was hoping that we'd be able to sort of use it to line the walls of my new home. However, no, it was very light and very fluffy. I'm terribly envious.
This is delicious.
Thank you.
This is so good.
Moby cheeky, do you have some black pepper? I love it with black pepper. No, I think that Phil's a terrible liar. He's obviously a competent cook, and it's actually very irritating.
He's let on tonight as well that he's really competitive and he wants to win. So I think it was a tactic, definitely.
Right.
Now the charade's over, it's time for Phil to shake off his sheep's clothing and start acting like the chef we all know he is.
I am. I'm feeling much calmer, but I've just tried to pour some of the juices from the joint into my jus, and there's a lot of fat in it, so I'm going to kind of boil it down a bit and just see what I've got and taste it and try and rescue that.
Show off.
I mean, after what everybody said about the patty, I'm thinking...
All right, don't get too cocky, Phil. You haven't won that £1,000 prize yet. For main course, he's serving a second helping of his self-butchered pig rack of pork loin Dijonnaise with locally grown vegetables.
Well, cheers.
Thanks again for coming over.
And,
You can relax now.
I can relax. It's all done now. God.
I have to say, this boy
cooked.
I have to say at this point that pork is my least favourite meat.
Brilliant.
But it's been absolutely... I'm going to say it again. I'm sorry. Gorgeous.
Gorgeous.
Potatoes
are nice too. I love potatoes.
The main course was absolutely brilliant. Although it was pork again, it was absolutely delicious and it was cooked to perfection.
I just thought maybe the potatoes were a little bit washed out. A little bit... One was overcooked, the other was not really done. The carrots, they've been a little cold but crunchy. It was still good.
I think it made the pork tastier that, you know, that the pig had had a lovely life and that he was killed in a lovely abattoir or whatever it's called. Lovely.
Lovely. Abattoir. There's two words you don't hear together very often. Phil's impressed the ladies with his culinary skills, but would they want their husbands to wear the pinny?
No, but as a woman, if Greg... Because I think as a mother, there is a huge maternal instinct, isn't there? And you do want to be with your kids. Mm. And if both of us had to work financially, blah, 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 you know, it'd be fine. But I think if Greg was doing all the care, I would feel jealous. And I don't think he does. Because I think most house husbands probably battle and think, oh, I should be out at work, I should be providing. But...
When I first gave up work, I had real problems with the kind of, oh, I'm not earning... I was not earning any money. And I, for the first time since leaving college and getting a job, I was kind of like, men put a value against themselves about how much they earn, and suddenly I was valueless. So that was a real kind of a weird feeling for a while. It took a while to get used to, but now I'm used to it.
You're used to it.
And I love it, yeah, it's great fun. And I wouldn't swap it for the world. But
he says that he wants to go back to work at some point, but I bet he doesn't. I bet he's still at home in the next 15 years, just making out that he's found something interesting and important to do.
He just loves this. He's not a house husband with any resentment or I'm doing this because I have to. I think he absolutely adores it, and I think he's just superb at it.
If my husband would be a house husband, I would be so jealous. I wouldn't like it at all because I want to be the one who's in control of the household. I'm the one who can cook the best. I'm the one who can sort out the laundry much better than he could ever possibly could do. And I don't think he would enjoy it either because I'm a perfectionist and he knows he could never live up to my standards.
Thank your lucky stars you're not married to Simone then, Phil. Maybe you can impress her, though, with your dessert. Homemade lemon tart with creme fraiche.
Well, I didn't used to be a pastry maker, but then I found one of my parents' old cookbooks, really old, had a pastry recipe in there, and it actually told you how to make it shorter and longer. I thought, actually, that looks really easy.
Over the course of the evening, Phil's gone from can't cook, won't cook to master chef. But has his lemon tart also left a sour taste with his guests?
Phil did it all from scratch. He made the pastry and he bought the lemons and he made it all. It wasn't his own recipe, but still, it was a very impressive thing to do, I think, for a man anyway.
Oh, lighten up, Simone.
It was a little tart for a tart. The lemon, I mean. But I do actually like lemon stuff, and the homemade pastry was excellent.
No, lemon tart. it was nice, but I don't like lemon tart.
No,
I mean, it was good. It was good if you like lemon tart, but I don't know. But it was still nice.
I mean, I'm very competitive, and I thought I was either suppressing it or just trying not to get too competitive. But I think it came through today, and I was really very anxious. And I thought, crikey, this is going to be a nightmare. But actually, I'm glad for me, I think it's gone well.
I don't think he lied on purpose. I think he is maybe a little insecure about it. But he performed so well, and I honestly think in a few years' time, he will be really, really good.
But Phil hasn't got a few years, as the ladies have to score him right now. Have his porky pies affected their marks?
For this evening, I score it an 8. It was a really brilliant evening. I think the standard has definitely been raised. The only reason why I'm scoring it an 8 is I was slightly let down by the lemon tart.
Tonight, I'm going to give Phil an 8. Excellent menu, really nice food, perfect setting. Good night. Thanks, Phil.
I'm going to give Phil an 8 tonight because I had a thoroughly wonderful evening. I thought everything he did was absolutely superb and I just thought it was great.
I don't know.
That gives him 24 points. He needs an 8 from picky Simone to put him in the lead.
I will give Phil an 8. I think this is good. There was just, for my taste, too much pork. The potatoes were too soft, too soggy, and I think in 2 years' time, I would give him a 10.
You can keep your 10. He doesn't need it, because an 8 puts Phil on top with 32. It seems his act hasn't cost him points, but will he still be top at the end of the week? It's day 4 of a very competitive week in Cambridge. Giggly mum of 3, Rachel, was the first to cook. Her strategy was to enlist all the family to help pull off her classic menu.
That bit over there.
It worked, as she scored a healthy 29 points. On Tuesday, flashy estate agent Gail Norris planned to make an impact with her picture-perfect presentation.
Presentation is superb.
She succeeded, scoring 31 to take the lead. Last night, house husband Phil Webb made his bid for victory with a homegrown pork menu.
It's been absolutely gorgeous.
Gorgeous.
And it brought home the bacon as he took top spot with a score of 32. Tonight, uber-confident German host Simone Brennis is stopping at nothing to impress with a 6-course international menu.
Amazing. Really worked. I'm in between Jamie Oliver and Nigella Lawson, and I wouldn't say I cook better than them, but not less good.
And on Friday, bubbly ex-singer Carolyn Tyser is relying on her talents to entertain her way to the top.
The more I want you.
Yesterday's host, Phil, had played down his cooking skills all week, only to surprise his guests last night.
I'm very pleased with that.
Phil said he was a bad cook. I basically won't believe things that Phil tells me in future.
Did you say on Monday, I think, that you're not a cook? And
yes.
I think you did.
You told us some real porkies. He was lulling us all into a false sense of security. I was completely annoyed with him because his food was beautiful. No.
And the others have now twigged that Phil is deadly serious about the competition.
I think he really wants to win this, and he pulled every string he thought he has.
I think Phil really does want to win, and if he doesn't, I don't know what he'll do. He'll probably go off in a puff of smoke.
And do we detect a little smugness from Good Life fan Phil?
Knowing that I probably cooked as good as I could cook means that, you know, I feel I've done it, and I'm not going to worry about anything.
But he can't collect that prize just yet, as tonight's host, Simone, is equally confident about winning.
Bring it on, baby. Well, Nigella and me, we have lots in common, but I'm slimmer.
And so modest, too. But she's determined to live up to those boasts by serving a tricky 6-course menu.
I'm feeling horrible again. That's too much. It's too sophisticated, it's just way beyond what I'd never even attempt any of that.
To start her evening, Simone will serve a traditionally German aperitif.
Waldmeister Maybowl.
Waldmeister Marble.
Waldmeister Maybowle, which is translated, doesn't sound very nice, Woodruff May Punch. And it's a very traditional thing to do in Germany in May. And Woodruff is a flavour you don't have in this country, really.
Waldmeister Maybowl. I'm sure that's not the right pronunciation, but I'm guessing it comes out of a bottle. I'm hoping it is, so I can knock marks off her for not making it. I've got to find somewhere to criticise her because the menu looks fantastic.
Bad luck, Phil. Simone's aperitif is homemade. It's a white wine punch flavoured with woodruff, a fragrant herb difficult to find in England, but commonly used in Northern Europe to flavour drinks and jellies.
Put some lime in and then some champagne and then it's all nice and bubbly and fresh and beautiful.
Then comes the first of two starters, a fisherman's surprise.
It might be quite something experimental, so the surprise really might be a whole octopus.
Maybe she's going to have a nice fisherman to entertain us for the evening. Maybe that's the surprise. In his waders.
Simone's surprise starter is a homemade crab soup, a recipe she's been perfecting for years.
And I need about a kilo crab.
Yeah, no problem. We've got a live one in today. I'm just on the counter over there, crawling around.
So. Hello. So how old is this crab?
Probably about 4 years old, I'd say.
4 years?
It's a lady crab.
It's a girl, look at this. First of all, you have the red bit here, which is girly. And then you have the part...
Ouch, ouch, ouch.
Oh, no, oh, no. Oh, God.
Ouch. Sorry.
Oh.
That's why we usually have rubber bands on. Sorry, it just took me by surprise.
After that brave parting shot from the crab, Simone heads home to prepare her second starter. Baby stuffed squid with roasted vine tomatoes and yoghurt sauce.
That sounds delicious. I love squid.
When people say tomatoes and say vine tomatoes, all tomatoes are grown on a vine. What is it? That's just poncy. Stop it, Simone.
Well, it might be poncy, Phil, but this is another recipe that our self-professed domestic goddess has created from scratch.
I am not good with copying recipes. No, I don't like it because I'm far too creative for this and I like to do my own thing. I'm also far too proud, maybe. Because when I do a dinner party and then I say, oh, yes, this is the latest Jamie Oliver, or someone is recognising, oh, is this the latest Jamie Oliver? This would embarrass me so badly and I couldn't cope, so that's why I make everything up and I can say, this is the latest Simone.
The stuffing for this latest squid a la Simone is made with minced veal, chopped herbs, shallots and feta cheese.
Slide it into the...
She stuffs the squid with the veal mixture and will cook it just before serving.
So this is it, I just...
Without even breaking sweat, super cool Simone moves on to the stock for her homemade crab soup. First, she uses carrots, celery, bay leaves, shallots, and fish stock. Simone has kept the crab in the freezer for more than 4 hours to make sure that it's unconscious. Simone immerses the unnamed crab in boiling soup. This will ensure that the crab is killed in the quickest and most humane way and give Simone the strong flavour she needs for the soup. She removes the crab after 15 minutes. In typically flamboyant style, she flambés the crab legs in cognac and Riesling to add extra flavour.
If you could smell this, you would die.
Better not smell it then. She then adds some stock and leaves it to simmer. Finally, the meat from the claws is chilled to be used as a garnish whilst serving. For her main course, Simone is serving Ling Ling's chili pork with stir-fried noodles and a white radish salad.
It's just one of my least favourite meats. But I enjoyed the way, every single way that Phil had done the pork last night, and I'm sure I'm going to enjoy the Chinese pork tonight.
She knows Phil's pork dish went down well last night, but she's convinced her recipe will be even better.
And then I will do the opposite from Phil, because he put lots of spices and herbs and Dijon mustard and crunch and salt and pepper a lot in. I put in my pork nothing, water. Just water.
I suspect she's been eyeing up the competition and saying, right, OK, I'm just going to lift my level. performance for this. I mean, I certainly did.
Simone boils the pork in water for 2 hours to ensure the texture is just right. Then she makes the chili dipping sauce to accompany her pork with chopped coriander, soya sauce, sesame oil, garlic and super hot red Thai chilies.
I will try.
Oh, I wouldn't do that if I were you.
It's perfect.
Yeah, give it a minute. Yeah. Here it comes.
It's so bloody hot.
It's got her.
Ha!
If you can cope with chili better than Simone, all her recipes are on the Channel 4 website. And of course, Simone is confident the flavours will be just right, so Phil has nothing to complain about.
I'm going to already mark it down for being just way too showy and just cooking about 3 meals in one.
Oh, Phil, you've changed. How picky is this guy? After 2 hours of boiling, Simone's pork is perfectly cooked.
It doesn't look beautiful, I know. It doesn't look like Phil's pork, I know. But the sauce is the secret. And it's really nicely cooked, and this is the Chinese way, and it will be fantastic.
She slices the meat once it's cooled and will serve it at room temperature with her chili dipping sauce. Simone's final courses are her desserts, strawberry kebabs and an amaretti chocolate tort.
Sounds very good to me. What girl doesn't like chocolate?
To make the amaretti pudding, she melts 2 bars of top-quality dark chocolate with amaretto liqueur. She then folds in whipped double cream.
It takes about 3 hours to have it all folded in.
With a 6-course mammoth menu to cook, anyone else would be stressed out. But Simone is cool, calm and perfectly in control.
Whatever I do, I want to do it 150%. And even if I just sweep the floor, you know, I just want to do it right.
She finishes the tort by pouring the chocolate and cream mixture over a base of crushed amaretti biscuits. Then she puts it in the fridge so it's chilled in time to serve.
That's chocolate tort a la Simone with amaretto.
With just a few minutes to go before the party starts, teetotal Simone is finally having some trouble.
Oh, no!
Roughly translated, leave it, Mum.
That's not good. There we have something Simone can't do.
Surely not. She finishes off her white wine and Woodruff aperitif with some champagne just before her first guest arrives. And it's her arch-rival, Phil.
Hello. Come in, Phil. How are you today?
Fine.
Apart from this.
Simone is pleased with her aperitif, but Phil's taking it like cough medicine.
Is this good or what?
To Simone's relief, the other guests start to arrive. There is Rachel. Then Carolyn. And finally Gail. Tonight, German-born housewife Simone Brennis is cooking an ambitious 6-course menu in a bid to pocket this week's first prize. But her punch has already been criticised by arch-rival Phil, and now he's decided to query her choice of baby squid for one of the starters.
Well, I mean, as an ex-marine biologist, I'm not so happy about eating baby squid. That seems a bit cruel to me.
Excuse me, I was a pig last night that you butchered.
What is wrong with
me? I jumped to Simone's defence.
Pig had been allowed to grow up a bit.
This baby squid is organically...
That's what have organic baby squid.
Phil seems to have a plan to harass Simone, and it's working. For the first time today, she's worried. Simone pulls herself together to finish off her crab soup. She uses single cream and bread to thicken it, and then whizzes until it's smooth, giving her guests time for a wander around her house.
Gosh, it's so modern.
I can't have what I thought it was going to be like.
This is definitely my kind of house.
Yeah,
I'm swapping. I don't know if
I'd
she knows that.
I'd be a terrible mother if I lived here, because I just... whatever.
Oh, look what I found. How to be British. Oh, bless her.
She's obviously not read it, though, has she?
Oh, she has.
Ooh! Simone pours the hot soup into hollowed-out toasted bread rolls, then tops with pieces of crab meat. For the first starter, she serves her fisherman's surprise.
Surprise! surprise. That's the surprise.
Oh, wow.
Oh, look.
It's amazing, Simone.
This is a soup I was eating when I was first time in San Francisco and I was visiting the Fisherman's Wharf. And I ate for breakfast a certain soup.
It's great. Yeah.
It was absolutely delicious.
She was telling us how she was cooking the crab soup starter and how long it took. And I was just thinking, if you got six arms or something that we haven't seen yet, because not only had she done all this, but her kitchen was absolutely immaculate.
And her table's just as immaculate. She might have four more courses to serve, but she wants to lay it just right. And she's also ensuring her squid is cooked to perfection. Time to reveal her masterpiece.
Oh, wow, this is lovely.
It's nice.
Simone has used star signs instead of names as place cards.
Very clever.
Cancer, you are a gorgeous hunk of a man. I'd really like to meet up with you after we've done this programme.
Right.
Here's my mobile number.
What a shame for being so ugly, never mind.
Shall I meet Simone so we can learn about Simone?
Simone, you're a big show-off.
Oh, no.
It's lovely. I don't think it's fair for somebody else to say he's showing off because, you know, she just wants to impress and push the boat out and I think that's quite different to showing off.
Good on you, Rachel. Simone has decided to get her own back by not serving Phil any squid.
This is Phil's dish because he was making a comment about squid and I thought maybe he would rather have... And he, you know, I've enough and if he wants to try, then he can.
For her second starter, Simone serves baby-stuffed squid with vine tomatoes and a yoghurt sauce. And for Phil, it's the fried meat stuffing without the squid.
So, darling, you don't have to eat squid. You can have meatballs. OK, even better, I get you one.
It was a joke.
It was a joke.
It was a joke. Oh, God. How bad do I feel? I'll have the meatballs as well.
Okay.
She just mistook my human. That was all.
Oh, that's what it was, Phil. Nice. Yeah.
They're stuffed with what? They're stuffed with?
Sorry, what
are
you
doing?
No, that's
beautiful. Turn it around. Turn it around.
Turn around.
That is absolutely divine.
Thank you very much.
Strawberry tomatoes are superb.
The second starter was squid, and I don't actually like squid. Well, I didn't think I did. But I thought, I'll try it because it's polite and I should just see what I think. And then before I knew it had gone.
The squid was absolutely divine. I cannot fault that in any way, shape or form.
Once Simone had actually put the squid on my plate, it was fine. I find with things like that, you can't actually taste the squid, though. We only tasted the veal, really, and it's a veal and herb mix. So it's a bit of kind of dressing, really.
Phil's competitive edge has come across so much more this evening, and it's hilarious to watch it. It's really making me laugh, and I've been times I've wanted to snigger out loud and I've managed to hold it in and just cough.
All that prepping the table and those two starters mean it's already 9:30, and Simone hasn't served her main yet, but she's determined to take her time, freshly cooking her noodles from scratch.
This will take a little while, actually.
For her main course, she serves Ling Ling's pork with a chilli dipping sauce, stir-fried noodles and a white radish salad. And for once, it's not her own creation. It's a recipe she's borrowed from her friend Ling Ling.
Oh, and chopsticks. Excellent. Yay. I really hate it when you go to Chinese and you don't get chopsticks. You have to ask for them.
Ah, look at that.
Yep. Oh.
You're not supposed to put your chopstick in like that, 'cause it's bad luck.
Oh, is it?
What
is it?
What is?
The Chinese never leave their chopsticks like that.
I'm not Chinese, Phil. I can do this.
Most of us would stop there, but not Phil. He's found something else to have a gripe about.
What do you think, Phil?
It's lovely. I have to say, my taste buds are bombarded by the sauce, so I can't really taste much actual pork by the time I've got it in my mouth.
No, actually, that's the idea. You don't have to taste the pork because it's just a background flavour as well anyway, so the sauce is the carrier.
He's feeling quite put out at the fact that it's been very good.
He's making lots of comments, Simone's got the money, Simone's going to win. So he's kind of, it's a defeatist attitude tonight.
So, did the others enjoy the main course?
It was really tasty, really yummy. And the sauce was wonderful. I could have just had a pot of sauce to myself.
It was a tad disappointing. The pork, for me, was just like leftover pork, what you'd have had from your Sunday roast.
Not a unanimous vote of confidence, then. And with two desserts still to come, Simone needs to stop striving for perfection and speed up, as some of her guests are getting just a little impatient.
It's all falling down a little bit, but well, should be fine. I don't touch it anymore, but no touching.
I felt that Simone could be the perfect hostess. However, I think because it was quite a complicated menu, and I think because it did take a lot of last-minute cooking, I don't feel that she was able to spend as much time with us as she would have liked.
I mean, it's taken forever this evening, so we're eating really, really late, and that really doesn't help. My stomach overnight, it all gets all gurgly.
We're coming down.
It's 11 o'clock, and Simone finally gets round to serving her desserts. The Amaretti chocolate tort and strawberry kebabs.
That is wonderful. Mm.
Blimey, Phil, can't you find anything to complain about?
It's very rich. That's why I only gave you a little piece.
Six courses later, and the evening still isn't done.
I'll just give you a little
it's bit. Over to the music room for a sing-song.
I close my eyes, drew back the curtain.
Don't give up your day jobs, anyone. The evening finally comes to an end. Time for some thoughts on those two desserts, please.
The chocolate dessert was really rich. You really didn't need a lot of it, but it was beautiful.
The presentation again was superb. Absolutely superb. Simone's excelled herself.
So it just finished it off. It was a grand finale.
Pudding may have gone down well, but Simone is struggling to shrug off Phil's catty comments.
I wasn't suddenly nervous because I thought, oh my God, Phil doesn't like my food. I mean, it's fair enough. If somebody doesn't like what I do, not everybody has to love it. I mean, it's taste. It's down to taste. Sometimes things do go wrong, and then after dinner party, I'm not satisfied with myself. But I must say, this time, I didn't have the feeling that anything went wrong.
Well, you might think it was perfect, but it's the guest scores that really matter.
We're going to give Simone a 9, because I think she just completely pulled out every stop. I think she had so much attention to detail, so much effort, so much thought went into it.
I'd like to give Simone an 8. I think she totally excelled herself tonight as a hostess, but I do think she did overdo it on the fussy stuff that took her away from the table.
My score for this evening is an 8. I had just as nice a time here this evening as I did at Phil's last night.
That gives Simone 25 points, but with her arch-rival Phil still to score, she could end up bottom or top of the table.
I was going to give Simone a 10 because she just cooked the best food I think I've eaten almost ever. But then she forced me to sing on national television, or rather try to lip-sync. So I'm sorry, Simone, I'm going to give you a very paltry 9.
Feeling guilty, Phil? Well, whatever the reason for the high mark, he's put Simone in the lead with a score of 34. It's the final day of dinner parties for our Cambridge cooks. First to host was happy-go-lucky housewife Rachel Tooher-Rudd, who refused to let a series of culinary disasters dampen her sunny spirits.
It's melting already.
And she scored a respectable 29. Tuesday was the turn of stylish estate agent Gail Norris, who impressed her guests with her elegantly arranged food.
Presentation is superb.
Earning her 31 points and putting her in the lead. Wednesday's cook was house husband and homegrown produce fan Phil Webb, who tactically played down his culinary skill.
It's actually very irritating.
Despite being rumbled, he scored 32 and overtook Gail. Last night's host was self-styled domestic goddess Simone Brennis, who served a six-course banquet for jealous Phil.
You're not supposed to put your chopstick in like that, it's bad luck.
He failed to undermine his rival to the lead with 34. Tonight, extrovert former club singer Carolyn Types, the number one spot will change hands once again as she plans to give her guests a night to remember.
The closer you look, baby,
I know we're all starting to feel a little tired now towards the end of the thing. We need a little bit of a knees up tonight.
One do with some cheering up is last night's host, Simone, and she wasn't the only one to notice Phil's constant criticisms.
When commented on the chopsticks being placed in the bowl the way they were, saying that they were bad luck, it was almost as if he was wishing it on her.
But what does Phil recall about the punch?
I can't remember.
I went all out to win on his day, and I don't think he felt that he could have been surpassed, and I think he was really a little bit put out by the amount of trouble she went to. I think it was just a bit of jealousy, really.
It's C. Phil's happy to criticise the slightest culinary detail. So how will Cap?
I didn't want to have a lot of fun, time-consuming courses similar to Simone's last night, because for me it's more important to entertain and be a host to my guests.
After 4 days of rich food, Carolyn's opted for simple dishes, and she's discovered a theme.
I suddenly realised, actually, every course is colour-coordinated to the kitchen and dining room, which was a bit spooky.
Indeed. Carolyn's called her menu a fiesta feast of colour and taste, starting with a boat of fresh pineapple and prawns.
Prawn and sweet and fruity. It's beautiful.
I think it's an unusual combination. It's not something I probably would have thought of, and I am more proved wrong on that, and I hope it's wonderful.
Extrovert Carolyn loves to throw a party and knows how to make her budget cover both the entertainment and the food.
They've got some nice frozen king prawns on offer, actually. You don't need to buy the best of... Quite frankly, if it's having a sauce on it, you know, frozen, what's the problem?
Shrimping on the costs, Carolyn. For main course, she's serving a sizzle of chicken paprika with rice, pita bread and salad.
Sizzle always sounds good anyway, sounds delicious. Chicken paprika with rice. I love pita bread, I love salad. I really like chicken.
I think I'm right in saying this isn't quite as sophisticated a menu as some of the others have cooked. But I think that's probably where Caroline is, you know, that's her style.
Oh. To make hers a party with a difference and scoop that £1,000 prize, Carolyn's off to her favourite shop.
Mediterranean, sort of tropical Hawaiian, a bit of a fun.
To pick up those little essentials no Mediterranean want.
With little flowers on, perhaps a little garland for everybody.
Very nice.
How do I look?
I'm on a raucous evening, actually, because that's probably what I've come to... Not expect, but that's what I've come to sort of...
Thank you.
Dessert was rather a late entry. It's a... I can't remember what it is.
Carolyn, you're serving coconut lime jelly with a puree of mango and lime.
Coconut lime jelly, that's very interesting. It's very unusual.
That sounds a bit weird.
I'm not a big fan of jelly or coconut. And I only like lime in beer.
But boy, do you love moaning.
I've only ever made this dessert once, so I am slightly nervous, but the biggest part of being nervous is actually if they can turn out of the dishes later.
Carolyn's got to get cooking to give her dessert the 4 hours it needs to set. First, she pours boiling water onto the jelly cubes. Then adds the rind and juice of a lime. Despite the recipe only calling for one tin of coconut milk, Carolyn adds two. That's a heck of a lot of coconut milk.
Nice sound effects.
She pours the mixture straight into bowl, covers with cling film, and puts them in the fridge till this evening. With the dessert out of the way, Carolyn decides to add a dash of glamour to her three-bedroom terraced house on the outskirts.
This is just a little selection of some of the stage dresses and stage clothes that I use for the girls to have a good old rummage through later, or try on if they feel the urge.
And to try them on for tonight's final course, salsa dancing!
I think that everyone will love the dancing.
The second thing I'm most worst at in the world is dance.
Simone will definitely, definitely love the dancing.
That's a person.
And I think Rachel will as well.
Now I'm scared. If you thought, you wait till you see me dance.
Which is why we all get on really well, I think.
By choosing straightforward recipes, Carolyn has given herself more time to concentrate on her theme.
I'm now going to show you how I made my serviettes. Here's some I made earlier. OK, so what you do is fold them in.
But soon, Carolyn's so lost in the art of napkin folding, she doesn't notice there's a strange boy in her living room.
Oh, my God! That's perfect! Are you all right, darling?
Yeah. Ooh.
In her bid for victory, Carolyn has enrolled the help of her best friend's son.
He's going to be my sexy waiter for this evening, but I might need you to do a little bit of hoovering.
Yeah,
is that OK?
Yeah, I'll do that.
I've got a little surprise for you, just a very small surprise. Excuse my bum.
Stupid set. I'll try it on, but I'm not...
Oh, God, Craig, why do you not want to show that fabulous body off? Look at it! Oh, my God, if you weren't my best friend's son and you weren't about half my age.
Not embarrassing at all for Craig. Carolyn sets him to work getting the house in order for the party while she tears herself back to her main course, a sizzle of paprika chicken.
So, a little bit of extra virgin olive oil. See, it's not mine.
And fries it in olive oil.
Once it's just coated and brown, just pop it in the dish.
Then uses the same frying pan to soften the onions. Bar Hill, but it's starting to look like Wisteria Lane.
A little tip, when you've been kins or... cos it always leaves a really bad smell on your face, is don't wash your hands in hot water. Don't know that. No? Is it when you use hot water, when you've got garlic on your fingers, it just ingrains the smell deeper into your fingers?
Yeah, you want to lose cold water and lemon juice.
Lemon juice, that's it. Or cold water if you haven't got any lemon juice.
Not just a pretty face. She adds the peppers to the onions, some garlic, tomatoes, leaves. With the party fast approaching, does Carolyn think she's in with a chance of winning that £1,000 prize?
But hopefully my time into other areas that may fall in designer cookery. Whew, I can smell the garlic now.
Phil doesn't deserve to win because of his behaviour last night.
I suspect that Simone will win. Simply because she was so accomplished.
I think it'd be quite close between Phil and Simone.
I'd love it if Carolyn won, but obviously I haven't tasted anything yet.
That was paprika.
Big old lump, that might be too much.
Spending time creating the right atmosphere has taken longer than Carolyn thought.
Oh, hysteria's setting in now. That's about as much as I've got time for, so in it's going. I'm so excited, and I just can't hide it. Oh, my God!
She's about to lose control, and I think she likes it. But first, Carolyn has to make her cocktail sauce for her staff. A boat of fresh pineapple with prawns.
As it's now gone 5 o'clock, and I need to have a bath, I'm hoping I've got some seafood sauce in reserve somewhere. So, in other words, I'm going to...
I think all needs to be fresh, yeah, definitely. And I think this is what she definitely will do.
He asks me, I might be tempted to keep my gob shut. Now to add a little lemon juice, but I don't know. Oh, Craig, do you know how much lemon to add to a jar this size?
Put it to that.
Okay, cheers, thanks.
It should be okay.
This is my new keep fit regime.
She adds lemon juice, mixes with the prawns.
No, it's not really. I juice myself. And I have stirred it.
And puts in the fridge till this evening.
That's it. I'm going to have a bath. I'm so excited, and I just can't hide.
I'm about to lose control, and I think I like it. All changed for the party, she quickly sets the table.
Oh, God! Me and Piesta... I can't say it.
Then she cuts apple into boats, but they're of titanic proportions.
I've got to somehow get them in the fridge, and I have no fridge space.
There's only one thing for...
I'm ever so sorry to bother you. Have you got that I could put 5 plates of pineapple on until I need them in about an hour's time?
That's why good neighbours become good friends.
There won't be much left.
Oh, don't you dare!
If you've got a neighbour with a large fridge and you fancy making Carolyn's recipes, go to the Channel 4 website.
Just for you later. Thank you. Do I need confetti or do you think that'll be overdoing it?
It's not a wedding. But finally, it is party time, as first guest Gail arrives.
Hi, baby!
beautiful.
Followed by Rachel.
Thank you.
Carolyn, I don't think Rachel can breathe. Then Simone.
Hey, look at you with your shades on.
Yay!
And finally, oh, Phil. It's the final evening of this week's dinner parties in Cambridge with domestic... The only person who can steal the £1,000 prize is tonight's host, ex-singer Carolyn Tyser, who's chosen quick and easy dishes and focus on some little party extras. Last night at Simone's, her rival Phil appeared to find fault with every course.
Apparently I'm really upset, Simone.
Oh, so can we have a little kiss and make up?
I'm begging humbly for forgiveness.
You don't have to snog him with tongues, but have a little kiss and make up.
Oh, please, Simone.
Give him a... Go on, give him...
Give him a snog.
Oh, yeah. It was absolutely not meant. And I hope when you see what school I've given you, you'll realise how fantastic I thought your evening was.
Thank
you. OK, I gave you at least two.
For her first party trick, Carolyn's lured in the help of her best friend's son.
I have a little surprise for you all. The sexiest waiter in the world!
Hey!
Oh, my! Oh, my God!
Frey, would you like to do what you do best? No, not that. The drinks. Yes. The drinks, the drinks.
Does anyone else feel that this is all terribly wrong?
Tonight is the last night. I want everybody to have a great party night.
With his apology accepted, Simone takes Phil upstairs to do a bit of dressing up.
Excellent, thank you. Wow!
I'm waiting to see the picture of her with some showbiz celeb type.
If you had to, which one would you choose?
Oh, gosh.
No, that's too rude. It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
I'm not going in this. No way.
Well, you know,
I've said sorry.
Give it a go, you know.
May I?
Time for the starter. Or rather, time for that party game, collect your starter from the next-door neighbour's house.
Hello! Ooh.
Wow, look at this.
It's not finished yet.
It smells great.
Does everybody like prawns?
Yes.
No.
No. No, I'm allergic.
I'm allergic to you. You are allergic? Me too.
Oh, you know, it's a load of rubbish, darling.
Joking.
Like you think I need any more stress tonight.
For her first course, Carolyn serves a boat of fresh pineapple with prawns in a cocktail sauce, straight out of a jar.
That's lovely. It's really, really nice.
That looks gorgeous. It's like a, how do you call this thing?
As everyone tucks in, Carolyn reveals just how easy her sauce recipe was.
Okay.
Did you make it?
No.
I was going to.
I think the sauce was made at length by Carolyn with mayonnaise and tomato ketchup and a squeeze of lemon. If she'd made the sauce, that's how she'd have made it, but she didn't.
It was really good. Tasted nice. It was nice to eat. And it looked good on the plate. I don't care if you made the sauce or not.
When I first saw it on the menu, actually, I thought it wouldn't work, but I saw myself stuffing chunks of prawn cocktail and pineapple at the same time, which tells me that actually I enjoyed it.
For Carolyn's easy-to-make main course, she layers boiled rice, chicken, and tops with a dollop of sour cream, and voila! A sizzle of chicken paprika with pita bread and salad.
It's been a huge success
on the rice. I think so.
It was lovely. Very different to anything we've had this week. Just how food used to be, kind of, before it got all fancy and silly.
She really, really, really tried her absolute best.
It wasn't as complex a menu as you might get
And certainly we've seen more sophisticated menus on the other good days this week. But it was really nice to eat, you know.
So Carolyn's simple party food seems to be doing the trick. But to bag that prize, she needs her tricky dessert to work. Good God. Might have been a good idea just to use the one tin of coconut milk.
They're supposed to turn out in perfect mounds and they do wobble like, you know.
And what better way to top it off than mango pulp from a tin to make coconut lime jelly with a puree of mango and lime.
I've definitely got top marks for the worst course of the whole week, haven't I? Can you see it? Oh, she's crying, Len. Is it that bad?
Is it that bad?
Aren't they? They will.
Okay.
I
don't like jelly.
But it's got coconut milk in.
Has it ever?
Not that bad after all.
Simona had the jelly and she wanted to say, oh my God, but she was so hard trying to be polite.
It was a kind of wild combination of jelly and coconut and lime.
And then she was like, it's lovely. It was so funny. I think I cried.
They have been so nice. It was funny. And even they said, I can't believe you laughed at it. But, I mean, what can you do?
When her pudding fell down, we all felt comfortable enough to say, oh, my gosh, what's happened to your pudding? She handled it amazingly.
And a disastrous dessert won't stop Carolyn ending her party with a bang.
I don't care because we're having a nice time, we're all having a laugh, and at the end of the day, we're now going dancing. We're going to do some salsa.
We've laughed and laughed and laughed. It's just been superb. It's been the best night so far.
She's the best hostess we've had all week. Her food maybe didn't match everybody else's, but her ability to make you feel comfortable and show you a good time was unrivaled.
The disaster, the dessert, if this would have happened to me, I wouldn't have coped because I try to be perfect all the time, which is completely stupid because you can't, you just can't. And she didn't even try to be perfect. And her personality made this evening.
Thank you.
So Carolyn's personality might have made up for the cock-ups with the food, but is it enough to win her the first prize?
I'm going to give Carolyn a 9 tonight because I've had such a fantastic time. Tonight has been absolutely superb.
Even though the food probably didn't rival Phil's or Simone's, the evening did. It was absolutely fantastic, and I've enjoyed myself 100%.
Well done, Carolyn. That's a fantastic evening. Thanks very much.
That gives Carolyn 26. She needs a 9 from current leader Simone to beat her to the £1,000.
I think Carolyn deserves a 20, but there is no 20, and it's a food programme, so I have to be fair, you know, for the sake of the other ones, so I give her 7.
So, Carolyn scores 33. Not enough to take first prize, but it's still her job to announce this week's winner.
I feel like there should be a drum roll at this point. OK, the moment we've all been waiting for.
I'm here.
5th. Rachel. Congratulations. 4th place. Gail. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And in 3rd place. Phil. Well done. And in 2nd place, I believe I got 2nd with that sweet. It's me. Yay. So Simone. Thank you. Well done. Oh, congratulations.
I'm so happy. Thank you.
Check it all.
Congratulations, love. You deserve it. You worked really, really hard. Well done.
I'm really pleased for Simone. Really, she deserved it. She really pushed the boat out. But actually, I also think that it's been fantastic and thoroughly deserved her marks as well.
I can't believe I didn't win with that dessert. I mean, my God, what were they thinking of?
I'm kind of speechless for a change.